Seeing the continuation of my talk of yesterday, I mean some generalities about CMC surfaces in the manifolds E3 of kappa tau. So my main goal today will be to present a generalization of the so-called Lawson correspondence. So first I will recall what the Lawson correspondence is, and also another very important phenomenon in the theory of CMC surfaces, which is the existence of something called the associate family, which is a family of deformation of a surface. So, the associate family is the following thing. So first we will recall the Gauss-Kodaty equation in space forms. Gauss-Kodaty equation in M3 of K. So this denotes the three-dimensional space form of constant curvature K. So you have det of S, K bar. K minus K bar equals det of S. And Kodaty equation, nabla x of xy minus nabla y of xx minus S of the bracket sy, xy, equals to 0. So again, k denotes the intrinsic curvature of the surface. So this is for the surface in m of kappa bar. So k denotes the intrinsic curvature. Nabla denotes the Riemannian tensor of the surface. And S denotes the shape operator, or if you prefer, it's the second fundamental form. Okay? So what happens here? It happens that we will try to rotate the second fundamental form. So we consider a CMC surface. We suppose that the surface is CMC. I will call sigma the surface as continuing curvature H. Okay? So what we know about S is that it is a symmetric operator with respect, of course, to the metric ds square. So S is symmetric. And trace of S equals 2H. Okay? So what we will do is the following. If we consider the traceless part of S, so the traceless part of S is the following. S0 is S minus H times the identity. So this is symmetric and has trace free. And it turns out that if you multiply this by a rotation of any angle, then what you get has the same property. It keeps being symmetric and trace free. So this is symmetric and trace-free. So I will denote by exponential of theta j, which is cos theta times the identity, plus sine theta times j. So I recall that j, I introduced this yesterday, it was the rotation of angle pi over 2 in the tangent plane. So this is the rotation of angle theta in the tangent bundle to sigma. Then it turns out, it's a small computation, then exponential of theta j times S0 is also symmetric and trace-free. Okay? So to see this, it's actually you consider a local orthonormal frame. You can write everything in terms of matrices. You do the computation and you see that it works. Okay, so what we can do, we want to produce another CMC H surface. So we want something which has trace 2H. So we will add H identity to this. Okay, so we consider maybe I should not erase this. J is the rotation of angle pi over 2. The complex structure, if you prefer. Yes. So we set S tilde equals exponential of theta j S0 plus H identity. So what is the property of S tilde? S tilde is, of course, symmetric. And its trace is 2H. Okay, so now what we are going to do? We will use the converse of this theorem in space forms. Recall that in space forms, if you have a surface in this space form, then the Gauss and Kodaly equation are satisfied. Conversely, in space forms, if you have a surface endowed with a metric and a symmetric, of course, S must be symmetric because it's a second fundamental form. So if you have a first fundamental form and a symmetric operator satisfying this and this, then locally you can recover your surface. And if the surface is simply connected, it's a global, you have the surface globally. Okay? So what we need to check here, what we want to check, is that S tilde, together with the metric of sigma, also satisfies this equation. Well, actually, it's quite immediate, because determinant of S tilde is the same. You can check that it is the same as determinant of S. So kappa bar doesn't change, and since I keep the same metric, K is also the same. So the Gauss equation will be satisfied by the first fundamental form of sigma together with S tilde. Then the Kodaly equation. Well, it's a simple observation that since H is constant, this equation also holds if we replace S by S0, because the difference is H times identity. So if you put H times identity here, here, and here, you get zero. So what happens is that it's satisfied by S0 instead of S. If you multiply everything by your rotation, the rotation exponential of theta j, it keeps being satisfied, because also theta is a constant angle. So you multiply everything by the same rotation. And then you add again H times identity, and the Kodaly equation is still true. So what you get, we obtain that the metric of sigma, which I note ds square, together with S tilde, so conclusion, ds square, which is a metric of sigma, with S tilde, satisfies the Gauss and Kodaly equation for M3 of K bar. Okay? So, assuming that sigma is simply connected, if sigma is simply connected, what we get is what? We have an immersion such that the induced metric is ds square, that is the initial metric, and the second fundamental form is S tilde, but the trace of S tilde is 2H, so we have a CMCH immersion. We can get another CMCH immersion and inducing the same metric as the initial immersion. Same metric on sigma. The initial immersion, and moreover, the shape operators are obtained by rotating the traceless part. And with the property S tilde minus H identity equals E theta J times S minus H identity. Okay? So we say that these two immersions, so they are isometric, with the same mean curvature, but obtained by rotating the traceless part of the shape operators, are associates. So these are associate emotions. These two emotions are associate. Okay, and a very interesting case, I will explain later why, is when theta is equal to pi over 2, we say that they are conjugate. Conjugate emotion. So the classical example is the helicoid and the catenoid. If you take the minimal helicoid in R3 and the minimal catenoid in R3, then they are conjugate emotions, conjugate minimal surfaces. Okay? So this is global when the surface is simply connected. If the surface is not simply connected, you have to take the universal cover. So maybe they are not globally isometric. You see, the catenoid and the helicoid don't have the same topology. So you have to take the universal cover of the catenoid, and it will be globally isometric to the helicoid. And in fact, you have a continuous family of deformation from the helicoid to the catenoid. It is the associate family. And this holds for every minimal surface in R3, and this also works for any CMC surface in the sphere in R3 or in hyperbolic space. So this is called associate family. Okay? So now we are going to introduce another correspondence of this type called the Lawson correspondence. So this is the following. It says that there is an isometric correspondence bijective between some CMC surfaces, but now we will change the ambient space. And also we'll change the mean curvature. So between simply connected, so SC simply connected, CMCH1 surfaces in M3 of kappa 1, of K1, and CMCH2 and simply connected CMCH2 surfaces in M3 of kappa 2, of K2, if H1 square minus H2 square is equal to, I never remember the sign, is K2 minus K1. Okay? So why is this? Again, it's the same kind of manipulation with Gauss and Kodaly equation. So we start with our CMCH1 immersion in M3 of K1. So what we get is the first fundamental form together with the shape operator, a symmetric operator, S1, satisfying this equation, Gauss-Kodaly, for M3 of K1. Okay? And then we want to make a CMC H2 immersion. So what we consider is S2, moreover. We have S2, which will be set to be S1 plus H2 minus H1 times identity. Okay? We define S2 like this. S1 is the shape operator of the first one, and we set S2 like this. So the trace of S2 is 2H2. So we will, if it works, we will get a CMC H2 surface. And if you do this, it's a small computation to say that, to see that you compute the determinant of S2 in terms of the determinant of S1, and you see that it works here if you replace here kappa 1 by K2. If this relation between H1 square and H2 square is satisfied. It's a small computation. And for the Kodaly equation, well, it's the same argument as for the associate family. Since you add a constant multiple of the identity, the Kodaly equation is still valid. So what you get again is that the metric of the first surface together with S2 satisfies Gauss-Kodaly equation not in M3 of K1 but in M3 of K2. So what you get is an immersion which has constant mean curvature H2 in M3 of K2, and which is isometric, intrinsically isometric, to the initial immersion. So this is called the Lawson correspondence. So actually, this is not, I don't think it is Lawson that discovered this, but Lawson was the first one to use this correspondence to do some geometric constructions. So how do you use this? So these surfaces are called cosine surfaces. So they are called cosine surfaces. So maybe I should say what are the main interesting examples. For example, you have minimal surfaces in S3 of 1 that goes to CMC1 surfaces in R3. And another very interesting example is minimal surfaces in R3 correspond to CMC1 in H3. So these ones are called Brian surfaces sometimes. So these are the main interesting examples. So why is this Lawson correspondence interesting? I mean, one reason is that we have what we call the cosine conjugate construction. Conjugate cosine construction. So what is the idea, quickly? So we start with a minimal surface. Bounded by straight lines, say. Or if it's in S3, bounded by great circles, pieces of great circles. Okay, so I explain R3, but it works also in S3. And then you do the conjugate, and then the cosine. So you apply the two transformation, conjugation and Lawson correspondence. And what you get is a CMC1 surface in R3, in H3. And what happens is because you rotate the shape operator by angle pi over 2, it transforms. It's a geometric property, it will transform the straight lines of planar lines of curvature. So it's bounded by planar lines of curvature of the new surface. And then you can apply Schwarz reflection. When you have a surface in H3 or in R3 or in S3, of constant mean curvature bounded by a line belonging to a plane and which is also a line of curvature, then the surface meets orthogonally the plane and you can do reflection to obtain, you can extend the surface by symmetry. So you apply Schwarz reflection. So then you apply Schwarz reflection and you get a CMC surface with symmetries. So it's a very useful technique. So for example, you have Lawson who uses this. You also have Kussner and Karsten Grosse-Brauchmann and Karcher also, and many people have constructed very interesting examples like this. Okay. So the topic of today will be to see if something like this can be done in homogeneous manifolds, in the E3 kappa tau family. And the answer will be yes. Can we do the same? In E3 kappa tau. Okay, so first thing we have to do is to recall the equivalent of the Gauss-Kodaty equation, which are called the compatibility equations. So these are the four equations that I wrote at the end of the talk yesterday. So maybe I will put them on the right because I will have to keep it written. So compatibility equations. In E3 kappa tau. So you have the Gauss equation. So they are a little bit more complicated than R3. Which is k equals to det s plus tau square plus kappa minus 4 tau square nu square. Kodaty. Nabla x of sy minus nabla y of sx minus s of bracket xy equals to something. Kappa minus 4 tau square nu times ytx minus xty. And recall that you have two additional equations. Nabla xt is nu times sx minus tau jx. And d nu of x equals sx minus tau jx in a product with t. So we have the data of the surface are ds squared, the metric, s, t, nu. So this is the metric, this is the shape operator. I recall that t is a projection of xi on the tangent plane, t sigma, and nu is n xi, the normal times xi. Okay. So if the surface is simply connected, and if these data satisfy these four equations, then you can recover a surface in E3 kappa tau. So we want to do a kind of Lawson correspondence there. So we start from a CMCH surface in some E kappa tau. The simply connected CMC H1 surface in E3 of kappa 1 tau 1. Okay, so this gives data ds square S1 T1 nu with trace of S1 equals 2H1. Okay, and we want an isometric CMC H2 surface in E3 of kappa 2 tau 2. Okay, so what happens? We want to find a quadruple like this satisfying the compatibility equations in E3 kappa 2 tau 2. So since we want an isometric immersion, we want to keep the metric ds squared. So what kind of changes can we do? Well, there are some changes which are natural. I mean, some thing it's natural to keep. For instance, here, in the Gauss equation, appears this coefficient, kappa minus 4 tau square, and this also appears here. So the most simple try will be to keep this coefficient. It means that we will set kappa 1 minus 4 tau 1 square equals to the same with index 2. Yeah? So we'll assume this condition on the coefficients here, h1, h2, kappa 1, tau, kappa 2, tau 1, tau 2. So this will give a condition of the coefficients. Also, it will be very simple to keep the same function nu, because if you change this function nu, the equation will become very, very different. So it will be very natural to keep the function nu. And also I will give later an explanation in terms of graphs. So we will consider, we will see if, so we will keep D, the same metric here, with S2, tau 2, T2, sorry, and nu, satisfies the compatibility equations in E3, kappa 2, tau 2. Okay, so what we will do is the following. For the shape operator, we will do the same as for the Lawson correspondence and the associate family. That means we will rotate the traceless parts. So we will set S2 equals exponential of theta j times S1 minus H1 identity. So this is traceless and symmetric. We rotate, we obtain something traceless and symmetric, and then we add H2 identity to have trace 2H2. Okay? So we do this. And T2, we'll do simply a rotation of T. Why? Because actually, recall that there is an additional condition that I forgot to write here, is that you have T square plus nu square must be equal to 1, because it comes from the unit field Xi. So you must satisfy this equation. So this means that T2 must have the same norm as T1. And so the most simple thing we can try is just multiplying by a constant rotation of some angle phi. And now we will see if these equations are satisfied in E3 of K2 tau 2. So first, the Gauss equation. So first observation is that we have a simple formula for the determinant of S2. So observation, the determinant of S1 minus H1 identity is the determinant of S1 minus H1 square. And the same for S2. But now, these determinants are equal, because this is obtained by this just by a rotation. So these two determinants are equal. So we have this relation. So now let's see if the Gauss equation is satisfied. So we have that the curvature of ds square is equal to that of s1 plus tau 1 square plus kappa 1 minus 4 tau 1 square, nu 2. And then we apply that this is equal to this. So det of S1 will be det of S2 minus H2 square plus H1 square, now plus tau 1 square. This, the hypothesis that I will make is that it's the same with index 2. So we assume kappa 1 minus 4 tau 1 square equals kappa 2 minus 4 tau 2 square. Okay? So it works if this quantity is equal to tau 2 squared. So let's suppose that this is satisfied. In other words, h1 squared plus tau 1 squared equals h2 squared plus tau 2 squared. Okay? So these are two conditions on the ambient spaces and on the required mean curvatures. Okay. So Gauss is okay. Now let's come back to coded the equation. What happens? The same argument as for the Lawson correspondence in the associate family works. Here, you can replace this by its traces part. And so when you rotate this by theta j, all this is rotated by theta j because theta is constant. And then if you compute this, if you rotate theta by the angle phi, it's a computation that all this is rotated by the angle phi. So the coted the equation will be satisfied if theta and phi are equal. So coded is okay if theta is equal to phi. Okay? Now, the last equations. The last equations will give the value of theta. So what we have is the following. We have that nabla x t1 is equal to nu s1x minus tau 1 jx. So x here is any tangent field. So nabla x of t2 is exponential of theta j times this, because t2 is exponential of theta j t1. But on the other hand, we want it to be nu times s2x minus tau 2 jx. Okay? So the condition we get is that s2 minus tau 2 j is exponential of theta j times s1 minus tau 1 j. Okay? But now S2 is this. So what we get is exponential of theta j times S1 minus H1 identity plus H2 identity minus tau 2 j is equal to exponential of theta j S1 minus tau 1 j. And now what happens is the following. It happens that the shape operator disappears. It's on the both sides. And what we get is just a matrix relation. It's an algebraic relation between theta, the matrix E, and the matrix J. No? And it turns out that this equation is satisfied. It's a small computation if and only if theta satisfies the following relation. So computation shows it's okay if tau 2 plus I H2 equals E I theta times tau 1 plus I H1. Okay? Well, it turns out that this complex number and this complex number have the same modulus by this hypothesis, so theta exists because of this. Okay, so with this theta, the third equation is satisfied, and the fourth equation also is the same argument, is also satisfied. So what is the conclusion of all this? We started from our first immersion. CMC H1 in E3 of kappa 1 tau 1. We kept the metric, we kept the function nu, the angle function nu, and we modified the shape operator like this, and the vector field T like this. And if these three conditions here, here, and here are satisfied, then the compatibility equation are satisfied in E3 of kappa 2 tau 2 with CMC H2. So we have the following theorem. So assume that kappa 1 minus 4 tau 1 square equals kappa 2 minus 4 tau 2 square. H1 square plus tau 1 square equals H2 square plus tau 2 square. And tau 2 plus IH2 equals EI theta tau 1 plus IH1. Then there exists an isometric bijective isometric correspondence between CMC, simply connected CMC H1 surfaces in E3 kappa 1 tau 1 and simply connected CMC H2 in E3 of kappa 2 tau 2. And moreover, we have these relations here. And same function nu. Okay? So this is the result. So it's a kind of Lawson correspondence, but it's not exactly the Lawson correspondence because you have to rotate also the shape operator. So it's a kind of combination of the Lawson correspondence and the associate family. So let us now see which spaces among the homogeneous one are related by this correspondence. So you can draw the following picture. Instead of classifying this E3 of kappa tau by kappa and tau, we can classify them by kappa and the coefficient kappa minus 4 tau square. Because the coefficient kappa minus 4 tau square is preserved. So you have kappa here, and here you put kappa minus 4 tau square. So of course, you have no space above the diagonal here. So what are the spaces? So recall that when kappa minus 4 tau square is 0, we have the space forms. So here is R3, when kappa is 0. And here, on this axis, you have round spheres. And the fibration is the Hopf fibration. Now, on this diagonal here, you have tau 0. Tau 0 means product spaces. So when kappa is positive, you have the S2 of kappa times R. And when kappa is negative, you have the H2 times R. Now, on this vertical half line, it is when kappa is 0. When kappa is 0, it's the Heisenberg spaces, nil, of tau. Here, kappa negative is PSL2R. Depending on kappa and tau. And here, there are Berger spheres. Okay? So this is the picture.
What are the axes? One axis is kappa, and the other one is...
It's kappa minus 4 tau squared.
The other axis?
Yes. Because yes, on this vertical axis, the parameter is kappa minus 4 tau squared. Because it's easy to use this parameter to see this correspondence because it's preserved. So what it means that in the correspondence, for example, imagine you start with a minimal surface here in some Berger spheres. Well, you will be able to deform it on keeping on the same horizontal line because you keep this coefficient. Okay? And when you increase h, so h is 0 here. And when you increase h, you must decrease tau because h squared plus tau squared is constant. So decreasing tau means that you go left. Sorry? I say that this quantity is preserved when you do the Lawson this correspondence. Yeah. Yeah. So if you start with a minimal surface, you will need to decrease tau. And decreasing tau here means going left, because tau 0 is precisely here. So what you can do, you start with a minimal here, H0. And then you increase H. So for example, here, you have an isometric surface with another H, with some H, in another Berger sphere. And then you reach here a value of H, which corresponds to a CMC H sphere in some Heisenberg space. And then you continue, you reach some CMC H sphere in PSL to R. And at the end, the highest H you can obtain is this H here, some CMC H in H2 cross R. So this is the case, for example, when kappa minus 4 tau squared equals minus 1. Something I forgot to say yesterday is that you have a two-parameter family of metrics in this e kappa tau. But in fact, you can do just a dilatation multiplies the metric by a constant. You can multiply the distance by a constant. It's a kind of homotacy. And if you do this, it multiplies also this constant by some non-zero constant. So what is really important is up to homotacies, you only have three cases. Either this is minus 1, either this is 0, or either this is plus 1. So in fact, these spaces are a two-parameter family, but you can see one parameter in this family as just a dilatation of the metric. So geometrically, you have three kinds, if you prefer, of, the same with kappa, with this value, is any negative constant can be reduced to this one by homotacy of metric and change of parameter or something like that. But geometrically, it's just a homotacy. So you can always assume this if you want. And also the same for plus one. So for example, if you start with some minimal here, then you will reach some CMC in other Berger spheres, and you will reach some CMC in some S2 cross R. Okay? Now what happens here? If you put kappa minus 4 tau squared equals 0, then what you get is not exactly the Lawson correspondence because you have to rotate also the theta, but you get some combination of the Lawson correspondence and the associate family. So in this case, it's nothing new. In the case where kappa minus 4 tau squared is 0, it is nothing new. It is just a combination of the classical Lawson correspondence and some associate element in the associate family. So, we will call these sister surfaces. Two surfaces related like this will be called sister surfaces. So it's like cousin surface, but it's not exactly the same because precisely you have this rotation in the... so it's maybe confusing to use exactly the same terminology. So we put sister surface as terminology for this. Okay, so... what is particularly notable for examples? In our talk, we will sometimes emphasize minimal surfaces in nil. So minimal surfaces in nil is here. For example, you have H0. What happens if you set with H equals 0 here in nil of 1/2? Usually, we'll normalize the metric of nil with tau equal 1/2. To have this. What happens? Well, we have some CMC H in some PSL to R, and we reach here H equals 1/2, CMC 1/2, in H2 cross R. Okay? So this is so CMC 1/2 in H2 cross R gives minimally nil. Okay, so remember the definition that Pablo introduced yesterday. It was the notion of critical CMC. Critical CMC is a value of mean curvature, which is a kind of critical case for the global behavior of CMC surfaces. For example, in H2 cross R, you have spheres, and more generally, you have compact surfaces only for H greater than 1/2. And you don't have them for H smaller or equal to 1/2. So we say in this case that 1/2 is a critical value of constant mean curvature in H2 cross R. In the case of nil, the critical value was 0 because you have CMC spheres and CMC compact surfaces for every H positive, but no one for H equals 0. So in nil, the critical value is 0. It's like in R3. And in H3, for example, the critical value is plus 1. And in fact, here, the values you will get in PSL2R is precisely the critical value of mean curvature. So the sister surface of a surface with critical CMC is also a surface with critical CMC. Okay? So, this is the first interesting example. Another very interesting example is the case of minimal surfaces in product spaces. This is a case where tau1 and h1 are both zero. So tau2 and h2 are both zero here. But what you see here is that, in this case, you have any theta working. In the general case, except in this case, there is just one theta that works. But in the case where all the numbers are zero, the minimal surfaces in product spaces, any theta works. So what you get is precisely the associate family. It means that for minimal surfaces in product spaces, you have exactly an associate family like for minimal surfaces in R3. And it works only for these ones. For minimal in product spaces. Sorry? Well, you see, theta is determined by this equation in a unique way. And actually, if you want, yes, maybe I should say this.
What about the critical one? The critical one.
No, because if you change theta here, you see, if you change theta, you must change tau2 and H2. So in fact, you have a continuous family, but you also change the ambient space. Yes, that's what happens, actually. You always have this family of deformation, but in general, you have to change the ambient space. And precisely, in the case of minimal in products, you don't change the ambient space. So you have this isometric deformation in the same space. That's what happens.
Right, so when it's not minimal, you go to the right.
Yes. Yes. If you go to the right, you decrease mean curvature, and if you go to the left...
You can't do that when it's minimal, you have to stay...
Yes, yes. When it's minimal here, you stay here, yes. Exactly. Yes, yes. Actually, what also you have is that you can put... You can say it's the same space. If you put tau2 equals tau1, and you can put h2 equals minus h1. And then it works also. So you put tau2 equals tau1. H2 is minus H1. Then there exists theta. So you also have this correspondence in the same space, but only for one value of theta. And you get this. It is not something trivial. When in product space, it's just making a symmetry. But in the other ones, it's not. It's a different surface. It's not something that you can obtain by ambient isometry, except in product spaces. So maybe I should finish by giving some very simple examples of this. Well, first very simple example is spheres. This works globally if the surface is simply connected. So if you start with a sphere, you will get another sphere. So for example, if you have a sphere in nil with positive mean curvature, you will get a sphere here whose mean curvature will be greater than 1/2. So spheres correspond to spheres. A very basic example is Hohler cylinders in H2 cross R. So spheres correspond to spheres. Hohler cylinder. What is a Hohler cylinder? It's something which has CMC 1/2 in H2 cross R. And it is just a Hohler cycle cross R. And you have your Hohler cycle here in H2. And you do the product with R. Well, this Hohler cycle corresponds to a vertical plane in nil. Vertical plane is just a Euclidean vertical plane. It's a minimal surface. Other example is that in nil, you have something which is x3 equals constant. x3 equals 0, for example. So this is a surface which is just a rotational. And you get here some rotational surface in H2 cross R. Okay, so this is a very simple examples. Okay, so I think I will stop here for today. So maybe next week I will do a few minutes again about some general examples of CMC surfaces in E kappa tau, and after this I will detail more minimal surfaces in Heisenberg group. Okay, thank you for your attention. Yes, critical CMC is the value of mean curvature such that CMC surfaces with a greater value have a different behavior, a different geometric behavior from the ones with smaller value of mean curvature. So for example, if you consider hyperbolic space, you have spheres only with mean curvature greater than 1. And when mean curvature is 1 or less, you don't have spheres and you don't have compact surfaces. So you have a very different behavior for CMC surfaces greater than 1 or smaller than 1. So we say that 1 is a critical value of mean curvature. And here it's the same. In H2 cross R, you have spheres only for H greater than 1/2 and no one for H smaller or equal. And in Heisenberg, you have spheres for H positive and no one for H 0. So this is what we call the critical value. And in PSL 2R, I think I don't remember by heart the relation, but I think it's something like that. Pablo told it yesterday. I think it's this relation in PSL 2R, critical in PSL 2R. And in Berger spheres, in the S2 times R, you don't have these critical values because they don't all believe you have spheres, you have compact surfaces for every value of mean curvature. Yes.